Welcome back to the Doctors Are In podcast. I'm Reverend Dr. Katie Nix, and with me, the ever wonderful, ever lovable Reverend Dr. Phil Blackwell as well. We're talking about this story that these two legacy churches coming together, better together, and from it birthing something I think that's even stronger than before. And for this episode, we want to talk a little bit and hear the story from what we're calling behind the scenes, the leadership side of what was going on behind all of it. So I want to introduce this morning, we've got Janet McMillion, who was the staff parish chair, am I correct, chair?
Yes.
At Legacy Grace UMC, and then Irma Ruebling, who was also staff parish chair at Legacy University UMC. And so I think we're going to start there and just kind of talk about leading up to this merger. And obviously we know that Legacy University started the conversation long before Legacy Grace did. But let's start as leadership, as these conversations are starting to happen, what are you noticing? What do you think is going well? What is starting to set, I would say, a really good foundation for what will come next?
Well, from a University United Methodist Church perspective, we started thinking about the fact that we were going to have to do something about our church situation at least 2 years before we actually did anything, and anything ever happened. And the way we started was, as a leadership team, we analyzed our church membership and its what was happening with it, and also our finances. And we realized that we probably had a maximum of 3 years to continue as a active church before we would have to make some big change. And so that's when we started looking at various options. And we, by the way, informed the congregation through congregational meetings each year that we were looking at this and what the situation was. And they understood that things had to change, and it didn't. If they did, that great. But if they didn't, we'd have to make some big decision. And so we began thinking about what that might be. And we started not with a merger necessarily, but looking at options. And one of the options was to open a church in an inner city area, populated mostly by low income individuals, our families. And so we actually had conversations with conference officials, the district superintendent, and someone who was in charge of development of churches about this. And that went on for really almost a year. And then it was decided by the conference that this really wasn't a workable option that they could support. So then we had to start thinking about something else. And that's when we started looking at a merger. Grace was a close neighbor, and there was already some connections in that there were social activities between members of both churches. So there was some knowledge, and we were also aware of our interest in social justice matters and considered Grace had similar principles and obligations and work in that area. So it seemed like a reasonable place to start. And so the leadership team made the decision to contact the minister at Grace. And I might also say it helped a lot that the pastors got along.
Yes.
They were friends, so to speak. And so they worked well together in planning and communicating with their respective congregations.
I think there's something there that I really want to highlight, and is that, one, the proactiveness of leadership, rather than say, we're just going to play out this song until there's nothing left in the bank and we dwindle down. Like, an intentionality about, while we still have, from a position of strength, from a place of, we still have influence and opportunity and what's going to make the best impact. And I think that is a huge piece that I really admired about Legacy University, is the leadership's ability to have these hard conversations, not from a place of fear, but saying, what can we do now while we still can? And keeping all those options open as well.
And I will say, after the decision was made to request if Grace was interested, and they were, and so we knew we were going to make the merger, there was still some concern about whether people were fully interested in doing this. So we arranged meetings for the congregation to attend during the 3-4 months ahead of time. I'd say biweekly, we had an evening where we had a Zoom call available for congregations to call in and ask their questions. And the leadership team was there, and there was always commentary that we had to make some expression of what we perceived would happen. So that I think by the time we were actually towards making the vote, people were very comfortable that this was the right decision. So I can't overstate that process. It takes work. And in the meantime, the pastors were planning all kinds of things too. So.
And I think this is a perfect point. Jump over then. So Legacy University had been having this conversation for a couple of years.
Right.
But for Legacy Grace, we came into this process and only had a few months.
Right.
So what was it like then from a very different side of leadership hearing, okay, we kind of have a partnership, a familiarity with this church. We're now looking at a very different thing that's going to be require a lot of time to do as well. So how did it come from leadership side at University Grace as we're going through this process?
I would say it was I don't know if it was a surprise to get a request to do a merger, but it in a way opened up all sorts of opportunities and things to think about. Because although we did not feel as a church that we were in the same situation as university, we also were not really growing. We were staying the way we were and looking for ways that we could thrive and do better the work that we wanted to do. So when university reached out, it was, well, this seems like it could be a really good opportunity, but we need to try to figure out, is this the best for our church as well as for university? So, I'm not exactly sure why. It may have had to do with Pastor Diane's leaving, but we had about 6 months to discern. And so that we could, if it was going to be a merged church, we could do it in the right time.
Did that timeline feel stressful or freeing to be like, look, it's going to take whatever time we say it is the time it's going to take. So let's just put a date on it and say, we've got till this point. How did that feel like, especially from Legacy Grace's end, which like, we're kind of brought into this conversation.
Right. So we weren't thinking about it before, and then all of a sudden it was like pedaling as fast as we can. I like how you put the question, because in some ways it was freeing, because I think that a long process could have been really hard. And they'd already been through a really long process, so in that way maybe it was good for you. But we also were able to benefit from the discernment that you had done, and
yes,
we did our discernment in partnership with university. So in a way, Grace was trying to decide, is this the best for Grace Church, and is university and merging with university in particular going to be a good fit for all of us? And by being able to do that together, it made, I think, the process happen faster and the end result be almost unanimous decision
yeah.
to do.
I think there was a gift that was given in that, because our leadership was not in a place yet to have these conversations, but because we saw another church brave enough to do it and invite us into this journey, suddenly we were having conversations about who do we want to be. It was a catalyst, right? It kind of ignited us into this new season. And I think so many times when we talk about mergers and closings, we always use this language of like sorrow and grief and death. this was a gift. This was for both churches
to
be able to have this journey together. Now,
that's just a practical question, because part of the reality was that the lead pastor at the university church was leaving the church for another assignment.
Right.
So that in some ways helped you, I would think, because you don't have two lead pastors hitting each other in the head and then having the district superintendent come and make a decision. What about the rest of the staff at University Church and here? I'm assuming there was a musician, that there was education, custodial work.
Well, the other staff person was the organist, music director, and she was in a position where she was interested in making a change, and so she immediately started investigating and found a very positive change for herself. And so, and then as it turned out, the other employee was a was the office administrator. And so she was gonna have to look for another job. And so as it turned out, she did look for another job that was available, and it happened to be at Grace Church.
Right. One of the benefits that we got was that there was a lot of discussion and conversation about how do we merge the business of running the church. Mm-hmm. And having the office administrator at university be able to assist both offices, it was monumental amount of work, but it really in a lot of ways streamlined what we had to do, because there were things that eventually came into being after we merged, like merging the having a common directory that included everybody in the church. And that's really an enormous piece. Not only did we have to think about the staff merging, but we had to think about leadership merging, and we had to think about committees merging, and how do you get the work done? And I would say that although it wasn't do this first, there was a lot of stuff that was all layered going on at the same time. There was the pastors and the leadership teams developed the idea of a vision team.
Yes.
That was made up of people from both congregations that met under the leadership of the pastors, but also met regularly, did a lot of praying, and did a lot of the work that kind of identified what are the items about this church. They created church profiles so we could compare. How are these churches? What's the health of these churches? What's the finances of these two churches? And then that informed the development of working groups of trustees from both churches, of finance people from both churches, staff parish people from both churches, and then there was a nominations group, which eventually then made recommendations for what the new leadership team would do.
What did not work during this time, and now is business for the church to go back and pick up? Are there things?
I have a hard time thinking about what didn't work.
I have a hard time thinking of that too, and I think There were a lot of some changes that were made, but in the process of doing it, we also set up a mechanism where future changes could be made, and we knew where it would happen and how it could happen. So we had a sort of an evaluation of where are we and what do we need to do that kind of happened on a regular basis. So,
and I think some of this, and again, cannot be overstated enough, is that the leadership from both churches set a tone in what could have been a very tense, very stressful, high emotion situation. There was this commitment from both leaderships, from this visioning team that was thinking about not only the combination of the business side, but also there's a spiritual aspect to this as well. We're not just merging two nonprofits. These are two communities with stories and histories and things like that. This idea of that intentionality and that prep work behind it as well kept the entire tenor of this conversation right at that line, which, wow, we were getting a lot done, but I still have to say, we merged two churches and no one ever yelled at me. I never got the nasty email or anything. And that's, honest to goodness, I think is a testament to the leadership's willingness, how many phone calls you guys had to make, emails, the intentionality of, you know, it can't just be, well, we're going to absorb you in. Like, we wanted this to be a new thing. And so the new leadership board was a 50-50 from both legacy churches. Each committee had two co-chairs, one co-chair that represented from each church. Like, there was such a focus. And so I'd love to hear a little more about the intentionality behind it. What did you think worked well in prepping and setting this up? Some of the resources we used, some of the ways that things were done. What for you was like, that's why?
In Grace's history, we sent out one newsletter a week with information and things. For this process, we started a second every Monday. There was, I don't know if it was discernment Monday emails, but it laid out for the congregation and everybody who wanted to read it what was going on, how we were praying, how you can help us. And at the end of every one of those emails, there was a link where you could type in your questions, your comments, your suggestions, and concerns. Because anytime you have grieving or big changes or moving, there's a lot of wondering about, well, what's going to happen to me?
Yes.
The things I love, the things that I treasure. All of those things, there were opportunities all along the way. And the numbers of people that were involved in doing the work, just the work alone of deciding what physical items from the churches were going to stay, what needed to go to make room for there now to be two things. Every single thing needed a decision, and you needed a lot of people about that. So I think that there was always a rootedness in prayer and scripture with every decision, and the starting of that extra communication that was specifically focused on this process that we were going to and requesting, let us know, and what you're worried about. And people took care of those worries. Okay, that's...
Well, I think well stated. The whole idea that everybody's feelings were considered and questions were considered and concerns that something was not going to happen that used to happen or knew something new was going to happen, how is that going to work, was all discussed, and assurances were made that we're always going to evaluate everything we do so that if it's working well, we'll make it better. If it's not working, we'll try to make it better. If not, we'll do something else. So I think people felt very comfortable that they could always express concerns and they would be addressed.
So what I want to shift to here now is let's talk about, we did a lot of the prep work. We merged. Then you have the first 6 months of a very tired leadership board, because there was so much work done, but a still very fresh of, we now have two entities that we're trying to say is one new thing. Plus there's a reality of, you know, employee handbooks that need to be considered. And at the time we were moving over office manager, but also we were in a search for music director. And so talk a little bit about those first 6 months on this new leadership board, one, trying to get to know each other, because I think a good leadership board, you have to have, there's a give and take, a cohesiveness. You got to learn each other's quirks. And then on top of that, you got to learn a whole new church's quirks and manage so many emotions of, okay, we did this, now what?
I think Janet, that all happened in those administrative work groups. And I know that the staff parish group spent a lot of time looking at the employee handbooks and other policy procedures and comparing them and coming to some decision. And so that we practically had a revised handbook combining the two before we even started having to look for new employees or evaluation of staff and that kind of thing. So it was having that done pretty much ahead of time was, there's no way to overstate how important that was.
In a way, I think that a lot of that work happened in that 6-month time before we merged, but it wasn't finished. But the work groups of the leadership team, anyway, were happening before then. So when we merged as a board, many of those people were on that board. And so there was some knowledge. I have to say that a unique aspect of all of this was that we were doing all of this under the overlay of COVID. And we were wearing masks, we were on Zoom, we were sitting at tables, one person on one end of a 6-foot table and one person on the other end. And that made it that much more challenging to get to know people. But there was intentionality about how important it was to create relationships, because it was really hard work. And if you can't begin to trust the people you're working with, then those decisions either take that much longer or they don't happen at all. I would say Diane and Katie's leadership, encouragement, and pushing us forward, keep going, let's keep praying, but then leaving room for the people whose church it is to really make the decisions. In one way, doing this process, I know I'm not answering the question, one way doing this process really makes you aware, or made me aware, of how fragile the institutions can be. Mm-hmm. Because people come and go, they age out, they die, and the things can be changing, but it's fragile. And so nurturing those relationships and building it on what is the work that God wants us to do in this world, which is the whole reason that we're in a church. So it's pretty easy for that to sometimes be subsumed by how many place settings do we need in the kitchen area?
I wondered how many times we compared this merger to the very idea of a wedding, right? And all the questions we have, well, are we keeping your grandma's china or my grandma's china? And who gets the first holiday? The phrase there, I think, that encompasses everything, and it was Pastor Diane who taught me it, we move at the speed of trust. And anytime we would start, I think leadership would start to feel the tension rise, things would start, we'd have some struggles in our conversation, Diane would say, okay, stop. We got to go back. We need to move at the speed of trust. So we need to slow. And that's when she could take that temperature and say, again, we're trying to do all of this on Zoom. We're doing this with masks. We're not even in person yet in worship. And so that relationship and trust took care of what could have really exploded for a lot of different things.
One thing that we did, that as soon as we could, we did it on Zoom and then we did it in person. We had more frequent town hall meetings where people in person could ask their questions so that a lot of people could hear what was going on. So right, during the discernment process and then after, in the year after, we had several, because there were ongoing questions and there were still a lot of logistical decisions that were being made after the merger, too, that people were wondering about, had heard rumors about. So having those opportunities along with the emails, I think, was a helpful thing. I just wanted to mention that.
We're going to close this section with the question that we are asking every group that we're doing in this season, and that is, what advice, what thing would you want to share with someone going through the similar story? If you could have, people from leadership going, we're going to start this conversation, or we've been approached by this conversation. What for you is like, keep this in mind, this is the key that was so important in all this. What would you share? Your advice.
First of all, I think it was important to be cognizant, for the leadership at least, to be cognizant of the way, the direction things were going in terms of finances and membership. And then secondly, to have the courage to present the situation to the congregation so that they were aware of it and understood it. And from then on is just to be as transparent as possible and as communicative as possible and consider options. And then eventually you come to the one that is going to be the one that's the most feasible, and proceed again with transparency and communication with everybody, all the important people. Make sure that they have voice if they want to.
I would ditto everything that Irma said. I would add, one of the hardest things to do is to remain open to possibilities and to be compassionate, trying to think about the greater good can also be a challenge, but I think that is really important. And any way that you can begin to create relationships and trust. Prayer was something that happened all the way through, at every level, at every communication. And I think as a church, that's something that is really key. So praying with an open heart and listening for what God's direction is and what He would like for us to have, be the best outcome. As many people as you can physically bring into the process, there's room for many hands. And I think that helps with broadening the understanding of what's happening. And also, while it can make it a little bit more difficult to have bigger groups of people, it also brings more ways of looking at things and solving problems.
Well, thank you all so much. On behalf of the pastor who worked with you guys, not only through the merger, but afterwards as well, I cannot underestimate how incredibly important it was. Really the leadership that set the tone, that took the time to make the calls, the emails, the extra meetings, all of those things. It was such a team effort, and we were just so blessed by all the work that you guys put into it. So with that, we're going to wrap up this episode, and when we come back, more stories to hear.